Hi everyone, thanks for coming. Welcome to the part 1A lectures on ethics and political philosophy. I hope you're all finding your feet as undergraduates. I don't know if you've had your first tutorial, Oxford undergraduate, your first supervisions yet. Got used to this kind of crazy system whereby every week you're expected to start knowing next to nothing about a topic and then 3 days later debate it with a world-leading expert. But it's crazy, but it's fun, and the lectures play an important part of the process. During my undergraduates, the way I kind of came to see it was that the lectures were there to tell me what was going to be in the exam, and my study and the supervisions were there to tell me how to actually answer it. So the lectures I always liked best were the ones that gave me a feeling for the subject, allow me to put it in context and make sense of it, but didn't necessarily go into too much detail so that I would get lost and fall asleep. So that's the model that I try to emulate in the lectures that I give, and I hope that you will find these useful. So, just to make this clear, if something is in the lecture, that is more or less a necessary condition for it being in the exam, but just because you can repeat things or you know everything that I talked about in the lecture, that doesn't necessarily mean it's sufficient knowledge or sufficient expertise to get you a first-class degree. But nevertheless, there will be some difference between what we cover in these lectures and what you might cover in your tutorials, and your supervisions, I won't get used to it, and your supervisions are where you will explore these issues in the greatest depth. So you need both if you're going to do well. So we're starting 1A with my lectures, which are on political obligation, which I think is a very interesting and useful place to start, partly because it's a very foundational issue in political philosophy. Most of us view politics through the lens of the state, through the lens of the law, through the lens of political and legal institutions. And the justification for these institutions is therefore very important for understanding the role that the state and politics plays in our lives. But I also think it's a great place to start because it's a really neat problem. Compared to some of the other issues that you'll consider this year, it's quite self-contained and easy to understand, and the possible solutions to it are relatively straightforward and simple. That doesn't mean that philosophers haven't found various ways of making it very complicated, but at their heart, they aren't so difficult. So within these lectures, we are going to look at what political obligation is, and we are going to look at a number of theories about how to justify it. In this particular lecture, I'm going to start by addressing that first question. What is political obligation? Why do we care about it? And then I'm going to look at some theories in the classical social contract tradition of political obligation. That's a tradition which implies that obligation rests on some kind of consent or agreement to political institutions and to the law. And I'm going to explore that by looking at a number of key thinkers. Firstly, I'm going to tell you what social contract theory is. Then I'm going to look at Thomas Hobbes, a very foundational scholar in both political philosophy more generally, but also within this field, and see why he thought that the social contract was a contract between what we might label the strong and the weak in order to prevent a war of all against all. Then I will look at someone with a very different view of political contracts, almost diametrically opposed view, which is Jean-Jacques Rousseau, who proposed something more like the social contract being an agreement between the rich and the poor to protect private property and thus create the institutions for self-improvement and luxury and some of the good things that we get to enjoy in life. And then I'm going to look at a number of later scholars, Edmund Burke, Mary Wollstonecraft, and David Hume, and what they have to say that impacts on this debate. So, political obligation. There's a number of ways of characterising the problem. This is the one we're going to look at here. Do we have an obligation to obey the law? Now, before I answer this question, I just want to briefly introduce you to what I consider to be the first rule of philosophy, of being a good philosopher and understanding what good philosophers do. And that is that you need to define your terms. Because this statement is not clear. What is it talking about? What sort of obligation? What sort of laws? And even who are the we who are being discussed here? Who is it who is supposed to have this obligation? So when you get faced by an unclear statement or an unclear question in philosophy, the first thing you do is you go and define some of the terms. So these are the definitions that we will be working with in this course. When we talk about the law, we mean what you might call the law of the land, the law of political institutions, of the government, laws and regulations. And these are typically characterized by three features. They're universal, they apply to everyone, not just to some particular association or group. They are non-voluntary. You don't get to choose whether or not these laws apply to you or how they apply to you. Those things are set in stone by the political institutions which determine the law. And also they're obligatory. You have a choice whether to obey them or not, but if you choose not to obey them, bad stuff may well happen to you. You may get prosecuted, you may get fined, you may get imprisoned, you may get any number of other sanctions. However, the ought in ought we to obey the law is a moral ought. And that means it doesn't matter that these are universal, non-voluntary, coercive obligations on us. Many people think that there is still some other reason why you should do them. The law is the law, and good people obey the law, even if they might not get found out, even if they feel that it doesn't apply to them, even if they think it is a bad idea. There is just something morally important about being law-abiding. Therefore, the we in this statement are moral individuals. Not just anyone, but people who, according to some theory of morality, would be classed as moral. Now, there will be people who don't accept that theory of morality, and there will be people who maybe do accept that theory of morality, but just think of themselves as bad and able to live outside morality. These people don't concern us here. We are taking, in a sense, moral philosophy as a precondition for political philosophy. We're assuming that we know what morality is, and then asking whether morality gives us a special reason to obey the law. Therefore, we can reformulate the question in somewhat more precise terms, using this phrasing. If you are a moral person, then you are obliged to obey the law. Now, having introduced you to the first law of good philosophy, I now want to introduce you to another very important lesson of general philosophy, and if you had a logic lecture, you've probably come across this already, but it cannot be stressed enough for introductory first years, because this is something that every philosopher gets caught out at some point. If you're lucky, you get caught out at the beginning of your first year. If you're unlucky, you get caught out in your final exams or your PhD and it all goes terribly wrong. And that is that the truth of a conditional statement does not depend upon the truth of the antecedent, the first part, the if. Nor does it actually depend upon the truth of the second part, the then. It only depends upon the relationship between the two parts. This statement can be true and can apply to you even if you are not a moral agent, according to a particular theory of morality. Furthermore, this statement can be true and can apply to you even if you think you have obligations to obey the law for other reasons. All this statement means is that it cannot be the case that you are moral and you are not obliged to obey the law, that there is no conceivable situation in which that could happen. Now, this is basically going to depend almost entirely upon what we see morality as being. We cannot answer this question in the abstract. We have to know more about what it means to be a moral agent. And so the structure that these lectures are going to take is that we are going to consider a variety of moral theories, which many people have taken to imply that you do have a special obligation to obey the law, and we're going to have a look at them. We're going to see, do they actually give us obligations to obey the law? We're going to see which versions of these theories are best at explaining our moral obligations, and we're going to see what reasons we might have to reject these as possible candidates for giving us the obligation to obey the law. So first we're going to look at social contract theory. I already mentioned that in talking about this lecture. That's the idea that we should obey the law because we have in some sense consented to obey the law. We have already agreed to do so. And the morality actually is constituted by that agreement. The second, which we will look at a bit next week, is that of hypothetical social contracts. These don't assume that we have actually agreed to obey the law, but they assume that under certain conditions we would agree to obey the law, and that that is sufficient to give us reason to obey the law in the situation that we are in. It's a bit of a strange move. I'll take more time to explain it next week. In the third, we will consider two more. The idea of fair play, that we should obey the law because we have benefited from the law, and as a result of that benefit, we are obliged to pay back, to be fair and not free ride, by obeying the law ourselves. And the final one is that we have some natural duty to obey the law, and in particular a natural duty stemming from our duty to uphold institutions of justice. Another one that may sound like a bit of an odd move, I'll get to it in week three. Then in the final week, week four, we're going to consider philosophical anarchism. The idea that actually there's no special moral reason to obey the law. Doesn't necessarily mean, as I said before, you should break the law, but your reasons for obeying the law are not moral reasons. So, it's classical social contract theory, the aim of this lecture. This is the view that morality is in some sense a social construct. Social constructivism is quite a modern idea. I don't know if any of you have come across it. People love to say, oh, well, that's just a social construct. Gender is a social construct. Race is a social construct. Morality is a social construct. It's a modern term, but it defines quite an old idea, which is that the obligations that we have as moral agents are not determined by some natural law, be it a law of nature or a law of psychology or a physical law or something, but they are determined by society, by how we structure society and by how we function within society. In particular, the social contract theory assumes that morality is a solution to a problem that human beings have. And to understand that problem in classical social contract theory, you imagine a situation in which there isn't this social construct, this socially constructed morality, in which we are in what is known as a state of nature. And in that state, you perceive that there is some problem to which morality turns out to be the answer. And through solving that problem, therefore, morality is something that we all agree to be bound by, because this, you know, it's better to do that than to face the problem of living in an immoral state of nature. And because morality is a social construct, its expression is also a social expression. It's an expression of political institutions and of laws and of regulations and of public norms that govern our behaviour in this universal, non-voluntary, and obligatory fashion. The first person to really put forward this idea was Thomas Hobbes. I realise when I'm putting these forward, you typically like put faces on these slides. I really like the sort of wall of text design. But Thomas Hobbes, if you haven't seen the picture, he's got a sort of beaky nose and a massive forehead. I often think that the artists may not, I wonder whether he was really asked to paint Thomas Hobbes or whether he was just asked to paint a really clever person, overly influenced by his genius. Thomas Hobbes was very much influenced by growing up at a time of religious and political turmoil. 1588 to 1679. If those dates don't make aren't immediately apparent of great significance to you, well, that means that he was born at the time of religious conflict, at the height of the English Reformation in Queen Elizabeth and the wars of religion in Europe, and it means he died after the English Revolution and the Civil War. And these events had a very significant impact on him. But equally important was the scientific revolution that was going on at the same time. And actually much of Hobbes' time was not spent in philosophy, let alone moral philosophy, which he's now best known for, but in scientific experimentation. And he was very much somebody who believed that we could solve problems by being scientific about them. Now, if you know much about Thomas Hobbes, what you're likely to know is what's on the next slide. That's why I put the stuff on this slide first. So, Thomas Hobbes was thought of the state of nature as being a hypothetical state, what people would be like without state institutions and without this public morality. But it was also a state that he thought that people had in fact approximated in his lifetime, during these times of great political and religious upheaval, and when there was effectively anarchy without an effective ruler. But he also thought that people in the state of nature were not bad or immoral. He did actually perceive that there was a natural morality, a natural law, that govern people's behaviour. And this was very important to him. This natural morality was based around a number of precepts that he'd arrived, including, importantly, as we'll get to, the idea that people should keep their promises and people should respect the property of others. But these could all be defined by this one golden rule that you shouldn't do anything to other people what you would not want to do unto you. And if you were indeed looking for some natural principle of morality, this is probably the one you go for. It is very universal. It's in the Bible, but it's also been found to be in pretty much every other ethical tradition around the world. The problem was that this sort of morality cannot be realized in the state of nature. So in the state of nature, people aren't bad or wicked. They're just unable to do what natural law tells them to do. This stems for Hobbes, and as I describe him, he's a very scientific man, from his understanding of human psychology, a very basic understanding of human psychology, but a discovery of what we now term the hedonic treadmill, the tendency for human beings to be dissatisfied by their situation. And for Hobbes, this was a tendency for once you obtain some desire, a new desire pops into your head and you have to pursue that as well. And the new desire is probably greater and harder to achieve than the original desire. Nowadays, we understand this in psychological and neurological terms. He understood it in the scientific terms of his day, in relation to the conservation of momentum, a principle discovered by Galileo Galilei. And as he put it, desire is but an internal motion, a movement of the soul towards what is wanted. And by the law of the conservation of momentum, when something is in motion, it will carry on in motion until something external comes to stay it. So for this reason, people in the state of nature, without morality or the state to tell them what to do, will be constantly desiring more and more and more. And since resources are always finite, it is inescapable that they will come into conflict with each other. This is bad. In particular, it's not only that people will compete with each other for resources, but people will be driven to compete with one another simply to achieve some element of safety. Knowing that I have what you want, I feel very vulnerable to you coming and taking it. Even if I am very, very strong, I fear that somebody who is weak will have the strongest desire, the greatest need, and will try and overthrow me. And even if I'm weak, therefore, I know that it may be hard for me to resist the attentions of the strong, those who could most easily overpower me, because they will feel constantly threatened by me, worried that I may come and take what they have by whatever means possible. So the weak will attack the strong, but the strong will also attack the weak to try and keep them down, to try and show them who's boss. And this is a source of Hobbes's War of All Against All that you may have heard of, his famous description of the social contract, leading to a situation in which life is nasty, solitary, brutish. I've got this one way around. Anyway, poor and short. Because we cannot resist but fighting each other, and that's very inefficient and ineffective, and not generally a good idea. So human beings in the state of nature face a dilemma. On the one hand, they want to be moral, they want to be good, they feel the force of objective natural morality that says don't do to anyone else what you won't do to them. On the other hand, the logic of scarcity forces them into a situation in which they know that if they don't attack others, they themselves will be subject to attack. And the only way to achieve any sort of safety is to be constantly taking on your neighbours, fighting and trying to gain what they have, because that is the only way to achieve status, strength, power, resources, and all the other things that you will need. And this is bad. So it's not just that life is solitary, poor, brutish, and short, it's also unfair. It doesn't give us what we want. And this leads to the solution. Get out of the state of nature. And the form that that solution takes is the social contract. Now, Hobbes' social contract often doesn't seem very attractive to us. In its essence, what it is that those who are weak say to those who are strong, you can do whatever you like, just contain our desires. Stop us from trying to get everything we want. That's all we ask of you. is just make sure that we don't get above ourselves and try and take things in our knowledge. Not very attractive, but then I guess you haven't just lived through a civil war. Maybe some of you have, but that's not the usual condition for Cambridge students. And it's certainly a very harrowing situation. By placing the strongest in this position of sovereign, they're able to escape the state of nature. They no longer are able to achieve these endless desires. And the important thing is, this is known by everyone else, right? The law is universal, it is non-voluntary, and it is coercive. There's no getting around it. So that way, you can actually get what you want. You can actually live in peace with your neighbour. Because you both know that there's only one person who can really exercise their will, but that they are obliged in doing that to make sure that neither of you can exercise your will to the fullest extent, and therefore that you are able to live in morality with one another and not do to each other what you would not have each other do unto you. In particular, that you will all obey the laws and hold other people to obey the laws. And thus, at last, morality is satisfied. The first state of nature, the first version of the state of nature, the first version of the social contract. Jean-Jacques Rousseau lived a century or so later in France, very different guy. Also very much an Enlightenment scholar, very much a perceived modern man, trying to go with the latest discoveries in philosophy, in science, trying to understand and push forward the bounds of his society. Unlike Hobbes, however, Rousseau is not that scientifically minded. Rousseau is a rationalist. Rousseau believes that we can know things just by thinking about them really hard, right? Hobbes is an empiricist. We have to go out and see what things are like for ourselves. We have to do science. Hobbes says, no. If you're clever like me, says Hobbes, you can work it out. And in a sense, to prove this, he made his name and a good deal of his living by winning essay competitions. At the time, people would put up large sums of money for essayists to come along and solve problems or find new theories and so on. And Hobbes was very good at this. Sorry, Rousseau was very good at this. He had both very powerful writing and a real knack for coming up with novel, new ideas. And this has made him very controversial in his own time and even right up to the present day. My experience with Rousseau's controversy was shortly after leaving my undergraduate. I went for an internship interview with a guy who would later become the Conservative Secretary of State for Schools. And he spent most of the interview telling me that he had big designs on how he was going to redesign schools because he'd read a book which had said everything that was wrong with education and said it was all down to Rousseau. I don't think there are many 300-year-old French philosophers who can inspire someone to redesign the entire education system based on personal animosity. But Rousseau has that knack. So what did he say? Well, his key objection to Hobbes and to people who took Hobbes' position was that we cannot imagine the state of nature as simply being what would happen to people in the present if they didn't have the state. Hobbes, you made a mistake by trying to understand the state of nature through the lens of the Civil War, because that didn't tell you what people would be like without the state. That tells you what people would be like if the state was taken away. The true state of nature that tells you what human beings are really like can only be determined by working out how people lived before the state and before law was invented. So we can ask some questions about this. He says, would people in this situation live in scarcity? No, they wouldn't. Why? Well, for several reasons. But firstly, their populations would be much smaller and they would be more dispersed. They wouldn't live in centralized communities like we did. So they just wouldn't come into conflict with each other, and demand for resources would be lower. Secondly, what people would want would be much simpler. The luxury goods that we have, the services that we have, most of the things that we really prize and cherish in our lives, are created by the kind of society we live in. If all you wanted was food and rough clothing, because that was all that anyone could have, you would not have these untamable desires that Hobbes and others describe. And indeed, I mean, if you go and look at quote-unquote traditional societies, but societies without great complexity, you often find that there are significant social rituals that involve the transfer of food, sometimes together with clothing, from one group to another, just because everyone has a surplus, more than they themselves can use, and it's good for social cohesion if this surplus gets moved around. Now, occasionally there is a glut, and then this surplus is used for other purposes. And that leads to Rousseau's second objection, or consideration of Hobbes. So would people be in conflict with each other? Would they be in this state of war of all against all? No, said Rousseau, because people are naturally sympathetic with one another. We like it when those around us are happy. We dislike it when they're suffering, when they're in pain or sad. So we are naturally motivated to look out for one another. Hobbes, you've just got it all wrong. Would the state of nature be much fun? Well, here I put a definite no. Rousseau is typically less clear on the matter. You definitely get the feeling that he thinks the state of nature is really good. He talks about the noble savage. He talks about people being genuinely free. But on the other hand, he clearly enjoys civilization and all the things that we have. He doesn't go off and live in the woods, nor does he advocate that other people do that. And on balance, we can probably say that it wasn't much fun because people didn't stay in this position. Instead, people's desire for self-improvement and for companionship and community and all these things that Rousseau sees as being so good leads them to form together, to cooperate, to specialise, to start living in complicated societies. Sadly, this for Rousseau is where it all goes terribly wrong. When people live in complex societies, their numbers increase. They're able to support more people. They're able to produce more kinds of goods, luxury goods, services, other things that are hoarded and more greatly desired. And so from a natural state of plenty, they move into an artificial state of scarcity. To handle this artificial state of scarcity, they have to come up with rules and procedures for allocating resources, working out who owns what. This, for Rousseau, is a social contract. The primary element of the social contract for Rousseau is that of private property. Now this works. It allows societies to function. It allows people to divide labour, to be industrious, to plan for the future. But it has a real big cost. People are no longer free. People no longer interact with one another based on sympathy and compassion. Now they have to do what the law says. And now they naturally come into conflict with each other. Because when somebody owns something, and that is defined by the law and private property, and I want it, there is a conflict. The law mediates that conflict. It creates peace, but it takes away freedom. So Rousseau sees us as bound by the social contract. The social contract is our morality. It's just that morality is actually not very good. And sometimes he talks as if it's terrible, sometimes he talks as if it's bearable. But nevertheless, the general will is to uphold this because of the benefits it gives us. There's actually the end of the social contract part of Rousseau that you need to know for this course. But I want to go on and just finish off his thinking, because in his social contract, he tries to work out how to solve this problem. That we invent morality so that we can have good things, but it creates conflict. Now, he thinks that laws only take away our liberty because they are imposed upon us. We can't all decide on what the law should be. So we hand that decision usually to a king or another dictator. Occasionally, you have a republican government, even in Rousseau's day, who's a big admirer of republics, but they weren't much better. Rousseau was the one who coined the term the tyranny of the majority. Yes, more people now get a say in the laws that are imposed upon everyone, but at the end of the day, most people have laws imposed upon them that they themselves would not choose. Yet, Rousseau believes we can have the best of both worlds. We can have liberty and security, property, and industry. We can achieve that by moving away from divisive decision-making to a state based on consensus, in which everyone agrees what the law should be. This, in a sense, takes the social contract to another level. You now have two levels. Firstly, there is a general will. People agree to live together and be bound by rules, because that gives them peace, security, property, industry. But then they also all collectively agree what those rules should be. And that gives them freedom within the law. So now you are still bound morally by the law, but not by its coercive nature, not by its universal nature, not by its non-voluntary nature, because you would always choose these laws, and you will always choose to obey them. Rousseau thought this was actually possible. Not many people agree. That's putting it mildly. But Rousseau thought that a small republic, where people could actually know one another, under an ideal constitution, really could manage this. You really could all agree on what the rules of the institution should be. And then if you have sort of JCR debates, so you've been introduced to these, but they would be a logical counterexample to this, that even when you have a nice small institution and you're doing quite straightforward things, actually, division does seem to be inevitable. But still, this is Rawls talking. Now, I presented these two theories in that order, because that's the order that Hobbes and Rousseau lived, and the order that they were writing. It is, however, important to realise that it could well have been the other way around. Rousseau objects to Hobbes. He says, you don't understand what the state of nature is really like, and so you see the social contract as better than it is, and so you believe that people are obliged to obey even absolute dictators, whereas actually he thinks that obligation rests upon working towards the will of all. But Hobbes might have come second, and he would certainly have objected to some things that Rousseau had said. We have to be a bit more speculative in working out how we would have done it, but certainly I think one of the things that he would have said is, Rousseau, why is it that you think that private property is part of the social contract? Indeed, it's the basis of the social contract. Can we not obtain private property simply from people's natural rights? Don't we all understand this golden rule? And don't we all understand that it follows from the golden rule, or if you want, from sympathy and compassion, that you just shouldn't take what someone else is using, and they shouldn't take what you are using? That you, in fact, assign ownership over goods based upon use and respect that. That's not the social contract. That's something that comes before. You get to decide, as philosophers, who you want to support and who you want to oppose. You might get to decide that you think that both of these authors have got it wrong. And we're going to look at some authors who think that. You might decide that they both have it right. And indeed, to the extent that we see that Hobbes and Rousseau might be talking about a real historical state of nature and how that came to an end, there's reason to think that. Hobbes and Rousseau aren't actually talking about the same event necessarily. Rousseau is talking about how people leave a very primitive state and determine things like property ownership. Hobbes is talking about how people set up states with rulers and laws. These two things didn't happen at the same time. Depending on which part of the world you're in, they happen somewhere between 6 and 10,000 years apart. And we could well say that, actually, Rousseau, you've got it right. In the agricultural revolution, hunter-gatherers decided to settle and form bands because they could get more resources that way. And in doing so, they gave up the completely unstructured life, unstructured communities, but I should say unstructured, but non-hierarchical communities of hunter-gatherers, and had to do things like work out property rights. And they had to work out basic laws and principles. They had to give up their individual liberty, and they had to accept some kind of social hierarchy. And Hobbes, you're also right that in the emergence of city-states and empires, towns and communities that has existed in a state of conflict against one another, bound together, either by choice or by conquest, to form big states with centralized bureaucracies, armies, proto-police forces, code of laws, and all sorts of other coercive mechanisms, and did so in large part to ensure their security, including their security of one against another. And it's been found that that is also correct. Where you have compact society, violence is less. It's up to you, but you're philosophers, so you have to give reasons. I just want to touch upon a couple of later authors who I think have some important things to say about this debate. The first of these is Edmund Burke, lived during the 18th century. Born in Ireland, identified always as English, but this was in a time when Englishness and Irishness weren't seen as being opposed to one another. And he was an MP. He did quite a few notable things as an MP. He worked tirelessly against exploitation by the East India Company and corruption by the East India Company. He also defined something that you may have heard about in various political debates about whether MPs should be representatives of their constituents, whether they should say, what do you think, constituents, and do that, or whether they should be delegates, whether they should say, look, vote for me because I'm clever and I'm a good decision maker. Most of his life he was a reformer, but towards the end of his life he changed his mind somewhat as a result of the French Revolution. And Rousseau developed quite a different notion of the social contract. It's a social contract without a state of nature. The social contract is there to solve a problem, but it's not a problem defined by the state of nature. So as you'll see here, Burke defined the social contract as not a contract between the rich and the poor, or the strong and the weak, living now, trying to solve their problems together. He saw it as a contract between generations, between ancestors in the past, the people presently living, and those in the next generation. And he argued that it's not about escaping a bad state of nature, it's about maintaining good states of justice. That for whatever reasons, our ancestors made sacrifices in order to build a just, secure, prosperous nation. And in doing so, they place an obligation upon us to maintain those institutions and to pass them on to the next generation in turn. So he didn't necessarily see that it was the building of the institutions that was about morality, because people might be motivated to do that because they could see the benefits of it, the benefits of cooperation. What morality was about was saying that you will always have some temptation. So this time it's different. Or to say, we think we could do even better. But you need to respect the value of the institutions that you're living in, because there's a strong possibility that what you might do will make things worse. So in the English Revolution of 1888, he thought this was great. It was about preserving liberty from a king who was becoming more dictatorial and more tyrannical. But at no time were the institutions of the English law or the English monarchy a threat. During the American Revolution of 1776, he also thought this was great. Yes, one country is splitting into two countries, but the institutions governing the American colonies are being maintained and being built up. People do want to have sovereignty because they see an injustice in, as Tom Paine put it, an island should not rule a continent. Well, they saw an injustice in that. But they were working to maintain the institutions of American government and improve them. The French Revolution, however, he started off supporting until the revolutionaries, that's what I'm looking for, until the revolutionaries threatened the monarchy. And then he turned against them. And this was before the terror, before most of the things that we see as bad about the French Revolution. But he said, if you do this, you will jeopardize the institutions of French society and French law. And things could well go worse for you as a result. And in many ways, history proved him right. And Burke, whilst Rousseau is a very, very controversial figure, who many people disown for one reason or another, Burke is one of these politicians, political philosophers, who tend to get adopted by every side in political debates. Right, I really want to get in Mary Wollstonecraft. Mary Wollstonecraft is not really on your syllabus, and she's not really talking about the social contract, but if I don't put her in, this lecture is entirely about rich white men saying what morality should be, and this is a problem. So at least let's have a rich white woman to balance things out a bit. So Wollstonecraft after Burke wrote his pamphlet Reflections on the Revolution in France, explaining his reasons for objecting it, Wollstonecraft said, no, you've got it wrong. She was actually the first person to object, and it caused this controversy, the revolutionary controversy, amongst pamphleteers, amongst educated, politically active people in the UK. And this has been called the last time that the politics of the United Kingdom was ever seriously debated. That ever since then, we've always been contemplating small, tiny, incremental reforms, whereas this was radical stuff. But she said, look, this is silly, all right? You can be attached to existing institutions, but actually there's a lot of injustice in the world. And you shouldn't use it as an excuse to maintain existing injustice. And in her first attack on Burke, the example she used was slavery. It would be so easy, Burke, she said, to use your argument to justify the continuation of slavery. It's been going on for a long time. It's an entrenched part of the fabric of our society. Let's not jeopardize things by tearing that up. But it's awful. Right? You can't seriously be defending such injustice. And she saw this sort of justice in the absolute monarchy of France too. But then she went away and she thought for a bit. And she realized, hang on, I'm missing something here. Why is not the same true for women? So having written The Vindication of the Rights of Man against Burke, she came back shortly later and wrote A Vindication of the Rights of Women. In which, I mean, she says many things, and she's not addressing herself to the social contract per se anymore, but we can see her as, in many ways, addressing this debate. And she is very much opposed to Rousseau. So in his discourse on private property, Rousseau actually defines women as being one of the forms of private property that men had to divide up between themselves. And in other writings, he said that women should not be educated, though he was a strong champion of general education, that their only role was to be good wives, and so they shouldn't be given education beyond that point. Wollstonecraft thought that actually women really deserve to take their place alongside men. And I think if we read into her discourse and look at some of the things she's trying to say, one of the things that leaps out to you is, in Hobbes, in Rousseau, in Burke, what is there for women in the sort of social contracts that they describe? Women were not in the position of violence that Hobbes describes. Hobbes's civil war that he was so worried about was a war almost entirely of men against men. Women are defined as private property in Rousseau's social contracts. They don't even get the benefits, they only get the sacrifice of liberty. And women are really not having a great time under Burke's version of the social contract. So why should we care about maintaining the institution of justice on their behalf? And in many ways, the same points could be made about many other groups that are minorities. I didn't mean to say that women are minorities, they're a majority, but so racial minorities, religious minorities, and so on. What on earth do Hobbes, Rousseau, and Burke have to offer these people to say that you should consent? And yet, most of the time, people at that time would see the women's situations being more moralized than the men. They are more bound by strictures of morality to uphold the codes of conduct of that time, not less. So there is clearly a hypocrisy. Now, you can correct some of this. You can go through and say, look, Wollstonecraft was one of the first really good female philosophers. She was by no means the worst. Sometimes we read this is rubbish, but she was certainly one of the first. And she was certainly the first to get much reputation in her own lifetime, although much of that was actually because of her unconventional lifestyle rather than her writing, but there you go. So maybe they didn't know that they were being so hypocritical. But there certainly is a problem here, that the social contract in the classical theorist does seem to be being written by the winds. It's not being written by everyone. And yet everyone is supposed to be bound by this. One final point of criticism I want to raise, coming from another classical theorist of the social contract, David Hume. Hume is skeptical in sort of in ways that other people breathe. You will be hearing a lot about Hume. Hume is the philosopher who creeps into every, alongside Kant probably, the philosopher who creeps into more areas of philosophy than anywhere else. And there's a lot of different versions of Hume. You will read a lot of different arguments. It's kind of hard to put one gloss on this is what Hume believed, but he extended to him to a religious skeptic. He was an atheist. He was prosecuted by the Church of Scotland in his day for being an atheist. They said, why don't you go to church? He said, well, I don't believe in God. But which is, seems reasonable. But he also extended his skepticism to morality. And to this claim, which actually, when you look at it, is a bit of an odd claim, that public morality as a social contract is based upon consent. He raises a number of objections. I really strongly recommend that you read this essay. Like, you know, you should obviously read everything on the reading list, but this is very worth reading. He really knows how to turn a pen, and he is always clear. But here are two of his objections. Firstly, he says, well, doesn't the social contract theory, does it rather misdescribe what's going on with the law? I mean, if you actually said, dissociate to a judge, oh, but you only have power over me because I consented to this, wouldn't they say, no, I have power over you because it's the law and I'm a judge and this is my job? You know, this is not about you, this is entirely about me. So if there is a system of morality that can be described by the social contract, can that really be the one that we actually live in? Isn't that some sort of airy-fairy idealist situation about what things could be? His second was the idea that anyone had consented. And he's got this wonderful quote, which I know you've got it there, and I know it will take a while for me to actually read it to you, but I will do anyway. You know, we may as well assert that a man, by remaining in a vessel, a ship, freely consents to the domination of the master, though he was carried aboard asleep and must leap into the ocean and perish the moment he tried to leave. This is the situation of you, citizen. No one ever asked you for your consent, and you don't really have many options for expressing your dissatisfaction but to give up your language, your culture, your property, your situation, and your status, and just about everything else you have. And that's not really a free choice. So what on earth are we to make of this? How can morality be based upon consent, as the social contract theory suggests? That's what we're going to look at in the next lecture. A couple of housekeeping notices. I did want to let you go a little bit early, as it's the first lecture term. But firstly, this is my email, sjb316@canvas.uk. Please do get in touch with me. I'm very happy to discuss any of the issues with you after the lecture, but I'm also happy to hear from you between lectures. I'm also happy to hear from you because you won't be writing your most of you won't be writing your essays on this topic right now, I imagine. But I'm happy to hear from you if you have your tutorials later and there's something you want to discuss or something you want to clarify. Please do get in touch. You won't see me around the faculty, if you are around the faculty at all. I work at the Centre for the Study of Existential Risk, which is a multidisciplinary institute looking at human extinction and how we can prevent it. And that's on that's in Mill Lane. So I'll come in to lecture, but otherwise I won't be around the Sidgwick sites. But I'm still very happy to meet up if you want. Finally, I'm trying my hardest to record these lectures. I know that Cambridge doesn't do automatic recording, but hopefully this is all now recorded nicely on my iPad and it will all be audible. And I will try and post it up on YouTube and you will be sent a message about that. Good. Well, thank you very much. See you next week.